On This Week in Enterprise Tech, it's the post PC era, and Steve Gibson drops by to talk all about encryption in the enterprise. Twyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 125, recorded January 19th, 2015, the Encryption Special. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by LDProducts.com, the ink and toner experts. Shop online at LDProducts.com for high-quality products at discount prices. For 10% off ink and toner cartridges plus free shipping, excluding OEM, go to LDProducts.com/twit and enter the code TWIT. And by Lynda.com. Lynda.com offers thousands of online video courses to help you, your team, or your entire organization learn the latest software, creative, and business skills. To learn more about Lynda.com solutions for your school, business, or government agency, visit Lynda.com/Twyatt. That's LYNDA.com/Twyatt. And by ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter makes hiring faster, easier, and cheaper. Post your job to 50-plus job boards with one click. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. Welcome to Twyatt This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballas here, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But I ain't guiding you alone. I'm followed by my regular cast of characters, starting with the very pixelated 8-bit Brian Chi, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, how is it living in a Nintendo game?
Hey, it's great, man. I'm at home being a slug, celebrating Martin Luther King Day, and I want to say, give a shout out to the people that are fighting for our freedom. You know, Martin Luther King was a great, great man, and he deserves this day in his name.
Indeed. And also, evidently, it's National Popcorn Day, so put those two together. Now, someone who's not celebrating with popcorn is Mr. Curtis Franklin, who is the executive editor of Information Week Radio. Curtis, thank you for coming back on from sunny, I assume, Florida?
It actually is a sunny day here in the swamp, one of our rare ones so far this year. But we're enjoying it. A cool blue sky day with sandhill cranes merrily honking overhead. But we're happy to be here inside and with the Twyatt Riot.
Well, gentlemen, let's go ahead and jump right in with some enterprise blips. The first one is something you've probably heard before because it involves Marriott and some Wi-Fi. Marriott is backing off their de-authing of Wi-Fi hotspots again. Just a week after telling the FCC that it was fair for them to de-auth customer Wi-Fi hotspots, which itself came 2 months after apologizing to the FCC for de-authing customer Wi-Fi hotspots, which only happened after they had been caught de-authing customer Wi-Fi hotspots for the better part of 2 years, Marriott is again saying that it will not de-auth customer Wi-Fi hotspots. Marriott issued a statement saying that while it will not block personal hotspots at their managed hotels, it will continue to clarify with the FCC what appropriate security measures they could take to protect customer data that would not block those Wi-Fi devices.
Remember FreeBSD? Well, hey, it's back. DigitalOcean has begun to offer FreeBSD instances as an alternative to the more familiar Linux servers, and there are plenty of indications that they won't be alone. Cloud services providers are looking at FreeBSD because it's a stable 30-year-old variant in the Unix family of operating systems. Seems that FreeBSD got a huge boost when it came out that WhatsApp, the service recently purchased by Facebook for roughly $1 billion, is built on FreeBSD. Mac OS X is also built on a venerable system, so it's not as though it's an obscure variant. It is yet another OS to learn, though. So pull out those old manuals and start building your skills for the FreeBSD boon that is certain to follow.
Well, we still print. And HP is actually shipping a new inkjet that's twice as fast as most lasers and half the cost. I had a chance to view a radical new inkjet technology about 5 years ago at CES at a non-disclosure briefing by Memjet. The concept is that the inkjet printer head is as wide as the paper, with print speeds easily reaching 70 pages per minute and higher. In a brief demo, Memjet showed off a 4-inch by 5-inch photo printer destined for on-demand photo printing. This demo machine spit out 4x5 prints as fast as your eye can follow. HP's new X series of printer is in the sub-$1,000 range for a 1200 DPI inkjet printer, with separate CMYK ink cartridges coming in at around $75 each, with a 3,000-page capacity per cartridge. Too bad I just upgraded my multifunction printer for this lab. This would have been awesome.
Well, guess what? Google wants to run with the enterprise big boys. There's enterprise IT spending, then there's defense enterprise IT spending, and Google wants a piece of that pie. The search giant has partnered with PricewaterhouseCoopers to go after public and private sector IT service contracts, believing that their strength in search, PwC's contacts, and their $60 billion in cash will allow them to partner their services in an ever-expanding enterprise juggernaut. Up first is a $2 billion contract to update the U.S. DoD's health records systems. They'll be competing against established enterprise players, HP, IBM, and Computer Sciences, with the winner of the contract to be announced in June. It should be noted that Amazon beat out IBM, Microsoft, and AT&T on a CIA contract in 2013, and Facebook has made a dash for big IT as well.
Hey, let's talk about QuantumBot. Now, if you haven't heard of QuantumBot, it's only because the NSA doesn't want you to. In some of the latest information to come out of that giant Snowden store of documents, it seems that QuantumBot is the name of a malware bot created by the NSA that does a number of things, including both creating malware that will go after enemy systems and hijacking existing malware. Now, it looks like QuantumBot will not only do these two very powerful things, but it also has the ability to mask, actively spoof where it's coming from, both in terms of point of origination and its command and control points. A series of malware that can create itself, capture other malware bots, and spoof where it's coming from. What could possibly go wrong? Now, if you're in IT security and look at this as a proof of concept, it's very scary. If, on the other hand, you view this as something that our government is doing to protect us, well, it's still scary, but just in a much different direction. Keep your ears open, though. This is just one more document. There are certainly more to come.
Wow, that sounds like Skynet. Anyway, wow, the latest FCC spectrum auction harvests close to $45 billion. That's a billion with a B, and that's for high and mid frequency bands, in addition to the lower frequencies previously lusted after by the carriers. We all know that lower bands have been the holy grail for carriers, since all those penetrating lower frequencies dramatically lower deployment costs for carriers. However, the surprise in this final rounds of auction is that the competition was fierce for the mid and high frequency ranges that could hint at new high bandwidth offerings waiting for Spectrum. What isn't a surprise is how well the mid-range microcell spectrums did that really got my interest. My spin on microcells is how they can lower the cost for specialized applications like convention centers, hotels, and the like, while still providing bandwidth capability to handle the higher load densities of gathering spaces.
Google is screaming to Microsoft, "Yo, Redmond, fix your Windows." Google has dropped yet another zero-day vulnerability on Microsoft, the third in a month. This time, it's a way to bypass application encryption of memory under the same login session. Though Microsoft asked Google for more time before releasing the bug, Google's Project Zero went ahead and disclosed the bug. While this may sound inappropriate, it should be noted that Microsoft was notified of the vulnerability on October 17th, back in 2014, and had promised to fix it 3 days ago on Patch Tuesday. This means that Windows users will not have a patch for the vulnerability at least until February 10th. Well, that's at the end of the Enterprise Blips. We're going to get into an Enterprise Bite in just a bit. But first, I wanted to take some time to talk about a new sponsor for the Twiat Riot. Now, when we were growing up, and by we, I'm talking about the people who are my age in IT, we were promised a lot of things. The workforce of the future, a world of high-speed communications, access to all knowledge on the planet, a more efficient workday, and of course, the paperless office. Well, the paperless office didn't happen, but at least we've got companies like LD. Now, LD is the one-stop shop for all of your needs for your ink and toner. Basically, it's a place to go when you need to equip your non-paperless office with some paper products. Now, you don't go to a car dealership to buy gas, so why go back to a printer manufacturer to buy ink and toner? LD products offer a quality alternative at a fraction of the cost. Some products are up to 75% off of OEM. They've been in business for 15 years, that's since 1999, and they're a BizRate customer certified and a Google trusted store, shipping over 1 million orders a year. And they know that you're not an ink or toner expert. In fact, most of us have no idea what goes into our printers. That's why they have people who are always ready to hear your questions that will treat you with respect 7 days a week from their U.S.-based call center. Worried about getting the wrong product? Don't. All their products are risk-free with a 2-year, 100% customer satisfaction guarantee. That means that you can return any product for any reason. But LD isn't just about good prices, great service, and an excellent return policy. Buying LD brand cartridges helps the environment by keeping oil, plastics, and waste out of our landfills. Plus, their call center, warehouse, and headquarters operate from a 110,000-square-foot platinum LED-certified building in Long Beach, California. So you know they're going to have the product that you need when you need it. Now, LD Products has your printer needs covered. Remanufactured, compatible, and brand-name products. To get 10% off ink and toner cartridges, plus free shipping, excluding OEM, go to ldproducts.com/twit and enter the offer code TWIT. And we thank LD Products for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Let's jump right back into it. We've got a little bit of an enterprise bite. This one, it touches a nerve for the Twit Riot because we kind of giggled. About a year ago, we were talking about all the experts and all the analysts who were saying, well, we're definitely in a post-PC era. If you look at the sales figures, if you look at the sliding decline of PC sales, they're gone. They're done. They're a footnote in history. Well, our panel was united in our derision of that analysis. We all said, look, the PCs aren't going anywhere. There may be more purchases for tablets and mobile devices, but the enterprise will always be PC-centric. And guess what? Last week, the industry backed us up. We've got an article here that shows that 83.7 million PCs were sold in the fourth quarter of 2014. That's a 1% rise and three stable quarters after the drop that brought on all the post-PC speculations. The Gartner Group analysts believe that the shift is the result of what they're calling stabilization. Translation, people have their supplemental devices, their tablets and their phones, and they're now spending on PCs once again. Chibert, let me throw this over to you. I don't know how many times people can be wrong about this. They said PCs were dead back in the 70s. They said PCs were dead in the 90s. They said PCs were dead in the 2000s, and they said it again in the 2010s. How many more times will the PC be dead? Chibert, you muted yourself.
Muted. Oh, there I am. I guess I am muted. Sorry.
Wait, hold on. Let me give you a clean break. Can you bug it? Okay, and just go from the question, how many more times will the PC be dead?
You know, I don't know. It sounds like a broken record to me. I happen to use a lot of PCs, and I also happen to use a lot of thin clients. But a lot of specialized vertical markets don't have the ability to virtualize, and they need a full PC, and they need to be able to put I/O cards. So as those get rotated out, you know, vertical markets like medicine, laboratories, car repair shops, inventory systems, and so forth, there's going to be a lot of these keep going out, keep getting rolled, keep getting refreshed. So I don't see dedicated PCs ever going away. I just see it being a cyclical thing.
Right. Curtis, it was really easy for these analysts to look at the sales figures and see how many millions, hundreds of millions of mobile devices were being purchased, how many millions of tablets were being purchased, and to see the decline in the PC and say, oh yeah, those are just going to replace the PC. But the people in the enterprise have never really taken that approach. I mean, even the most Gartner-centric executive kind of understood that we're never going to get rid of our desktops and our laptops, right?
That's right. I mean, yes. Are there some niche applications where the tablet can replace the desktop? Sure. But in general, they do different things. And I think what we really saw with the tablet was an expansion of computing devices into areas that were entirely non-computerized before. Walking around on a retail sales floor, for example, is the sort of thing that is very cumbersome if you try to take a laptop, and impossible if you try to take a desktop, but perfectly reasonable if you're carrying a tablet. Now, there are some people who tried to go in the direction of saying that all we want is one device. To me, that's the real problem. It's sort of like in a different scenario, the people who say, well, we can't have any alternative energy because no single alternative energy can completely replace what we've got now. There are different tools for different purposes. What we're finding is that we have more purposes, more applications for the technology than we thought we did 10 years ago. That's a good thing because it tends to increase productivity and make people happier. I know in my personal case, I have both a powerful laptop computer and a tablet. In the course of most business days, I use both of them just for different things. I think what we're probably going to see now is alternating cycles so that one year, one will be higher, the next year, the other one will be. Ultimately, though, the market for each is going to continue growing, I think, for some time to come.
Right. We've got CyberDog in the chat room, who's a longtime member of the Twilight Riot since episode one, who is saying, and he works at a school, most of our kids polled now have iPads at home instead of laptops, but that isn't making us switch to iPads in the classroom. And I think that was what you're talking about, Curtis, that fundamental misunderstanding that this device is going to replace all other devices, and it doesn't have to. And in fact, the enterprise has understood that for a long time. Now, one of the pieces of conventional wisdom was that as Intel goes, so does the PC era. Intel hasn't quite made that switch over to the mobile universe yet. I mean, they're trying really hard, but they're still mostly bound with PCs and servers. And in a conference call with Intel CEO Brian Krzanich, investors and analysts were told that PC shipments would actually stabilize in 2015. So we've gone through the worst of it, and that prices for desktops and laptops might actually see a slight decline. Now, he talked a lot about Ultrabooks, Chromebooks, and sub-$200 laptops. In his words, they're packing a lot of features into these devices at a great price, and that is what the enterprise goes for. Intel quarter four 2014 revenue was up at $14.7 billion. That's 6% increase year over year with a net income of 39%. That means that they're pulling in more cash and making more off of a project margin that is bigger. Also, most of that was from the heart of the quote-unquote dead PC. Chebert, Intel is making a big push into mobile, but it almost sounds as if they did not expect that their PC part revenue was going to stabilize and actually even start to make them more cash.
Well, you know, PCs are PCs. You know, there's people that need to do more things with less, you know, the desktop. And of course, wow, that was fun. And yeah, the whole deal is VDI isn't taking over the enterprise. Desktops are still going to be there. People still, you know, we've got more and more 3D going into the operating systems, you know, with Windows 10 going even further into the Aeroglass look. So I don't see PCs really disappearing. And Intel is betting on that. You know, some of the new desktop chips that are coming out are absolutely spectacular. And Intel is actually putting out more and more of these small desktops, like the next unit of computing, which is actually taking the place of a lot of thin clients. That was a big surprise.
Yeah, and actually, Keith 512 he just brought up a stat that I was going to bring up after that, which is Intel actually lost $4 billion on mobile. So they've been making a big push, but they haven't been all that successful. Where it does seem that they're getting it back is in PCs and even in servers. Another little nugget of information here, their server and chip component revenue jumped by 25% to $4.1 billion. And even their Internet of Things division was up 10% year over year to $591 million. Now, Curtis, I do want to throw one last bit at you, and that is there has been a lot of saturation talk, and it seems as if the idea is that buyers go back to buying workhorse tools once they have their convenience tools and their tools of status. That would be the phone and the tablet. Was BlackBerry CEO Thorsten Hines right when 2 years ago he said, I think tablets are just a fad?
No, I don't think he was right. I think, if anything, what the market missed was in thinking that the replacement cycle for tablets was going to follow the replacement cycle for phones. Phones tend to be on a 2-year replacement cycle. Laptop and desktop computers tend to be on a cycle that is closer to 4 or 5 years. And I think what we're going to see is that tablets are much closer to that laptop and desktop replacement cycle than they are to phones. I mean, let's face it, if you're getting a top-end iPad, you're paying roughly $900 for it. And for most people, that's a sizable chunk of change. If you are an enterprise and you need to buy 10,000 of them, it's a very sizable chunk of change. So I think that the industry got that replacement cycle wrong. I also think that we're seeing the mix of applications change. We're seeing a lot more people trying to do much more compute-intensive and video-intensive operations on their desktop and laptop computers. Not talking just about video conferencing, but big data visualization and the computing behind that presentation. A lot more people doing basic video editing. A lot of more people doing basic graphical editing as part of presentations. We are becoming a business society in which visual literacy is much more important. Right now, creating the visual content requires more horsepower and larger screen real estate. And so far, that still translates out to desktop and especially higher-end laptop computers.
We've got Jab in the chat room saying that he believes that the phone will replace the tablet. I actually stand with that. I think we're moving to the part where a larger phone will take the place of a tablet, and you'll have business travelers moving around with a laptop and a phone and no third device. T-Bert, I'm going to give you the last question of the segment, and this was brought up by Specs in the chat room, and that is it all about the price? Is this resurgence just because, as the CEO of Intel said, there are so many highly capable sub-$200 devices that you can now purchase?
Well, I think it's very much about the price. I am seeing more and more and more of these teeny tiny little i5 and i7 based computers like the Intel Next Unit of Computing. It's a great platform. It gives your standard user everything they need, including graphics capability, in a silent platform, in a solid state platform. And basically, it's your desktop version of what people want in a laptop. It's portable, it's easy to move around, gives you great performance. Enterprise, academia, research has always been price sensitive. And that's what a lot of people keep forgetting. When you have to buy hundreds, thousands or tens of thousands of a platform, that makes a pretty big difference. And this is one of the things I keep telling to the guys at Apple. If you're going to be rolling out a lot of a platform, enterprise is going to want these deeper discounts, and they're not going to want us to have to spend a lot of money on the enterprise tools to be able to get profiles, you know, the corporate templates to roll out these machines. And the problem with thin clients is they are still kind of hard to do. There's a lot of back end work. It's still not as easy to roll out as the vendors would like you to believe. And at the moment, the tools for rolling out enterprise configurations of PCs are actually really spectacular.
Gentlemen, thank you very much. I always enjoy talking about the end of the PC world, but let's go ahead and move on. Now, when we come back, we're bringing Steve Gibson from Security Now onto the show to talk a little bit about encryption, what it means for the enterprise, and what some recent developments in politics may mean for your IT folk who protect your data. But before that, let's go ahead and thank the second sponsor of this episode of Twiet, and it's lynda.com. Do you want to learn a new skill? Do you want to refresh an old one? Do you want to stay current on the latest and the greatest in not just software, but skills training? Well, that's what lynda.com is for. But did you know that lynda.com also offers multi-user solutions to help schools, businesses, and government agencies? With lynda.com, you can train your team, department, or entire organization, including all of your employees, students, faculty, and staff, on demand 24/7. Lynda.com integrates with your network for simple access and administration, allowing you to provide users with Lynda.com course content through your learning management system. This is the holy grail of online learning. Their content, their highly produced, highly professional, perfect sounding, perfect looking videos with content created by experts through your system of learning. Now, IT departments can use Lynda.com to provide a virtual help desk to reduce support calls, assist with upgrades and migrations, whether your team is upgrading to the latest version of Windows or Microsoft Office, or migrating to new applications. It helps you keep your organization up to date on the latest software and technology skills, like, for example, how to use SharePoint or Google Apps. It lets you train new hires on relevant software, whether it's finance, coding, web design, Photoshop, negotiation, Excel, productivity tips, SEO, and more. Lynda.com has video courses for every department in your company. For the Twilight Riot, there are also courses on everything from data sciences to business intelligence to network administration and enterprise content management. We use Lynda.com here at the Twit Brick House as the go-to reference for our entire team. And in fact, right now, we need Lynda.com because we're making the transition between using Macs with Final Cut to PCs with Adobe Premiere. And our staff needs to learn on the go. They need a quick way to get the answer to that one nagging question. And that's what Lynda.com lets them do 24/7. Now, to learn more about Lynda.com solutions for your school, business, or government agency, visit lynda.com/twiet. That's lynda.com/twiet to request more information. And we thank Lynda for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Let's get to the heart of the matter. We welcome back to the show Mr. Steve Gibson, our security guru. Steve, thank you so much for coming back on the Twiet.
Great to be here.
You know, sir, we had this idea about bringing you back. We haven't had you on the show since, I believe, November, to talk a little bit about encryption, because there's been a lot of news about encryption. Now, before we get to some of the more political stuff, let's talk about the hard engineering, the hard sciences. What are some of the things that have changed in encryption over the last year, especially since, I don't know, there have been certain revelations about snooping?
You know, a year ago when the Snowden documents first became, well, actually now it's more than a year ago.
Oh, yeah, 2 years. Yeah.
What, like, well. What,
almost. 15, oh, we're getting there.
I think it was late 2013 that this began to happen, like November of 2013.
Right.
And so we were discussing it, you know, sort of like over the holidays of 2014, I mean, 2013 into 2014. And so it's been more than a year. One of the things that was foreseeable has come to pass, and that is that people have gotten more focused on the idea of their privacy, because the question of whether there was eavesdropping going on has largely been answered. It's no longer, well, somebody could be doing that, but we don't know that they are. Now it's pretty clear that there is, if nothing else, a lot of intention behind the desire to be able to eavesdrop on communications. So, you know, we've seen clearly publicly made policy changes on behalf of Google with Android and famously Apple with their iPhone, saying they're turning over the keys to the user. They're not going to have any ability to decrypt phones any longer. And this has had the predictable response from law enforcement saying, whoa, 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 wait a minute. We need to be able to get in there. Now, the iCloud, the generic cloud providers have responded similarly, being more clear about the way their technology works. One of the frustrations that we had back in like pre-Snowden days, 2012, 2013, is their pretty websites would say, oh, you know, military-grade encryption. Put your stuff up here and it'll be safe. Well, the problem is that that we had to find out what their protocols were, how they were actually doing that at the crypto mechanics level to be able to judge from outside whether in fact they were able to deliver the security and privacy that they were promising. And post Snowden, there's been a greater level of disclosure of, like, you know, this is exactly the way we're doing it, and this is why you have the keys and we don't have the keys, and so on. And then finally, I guess I would say that there is this issue in the enterprise environment of the need to scan for viruses in encrypted communications, like, you know, in encrypted web traffic. Originally, I would say, what, maybe 5 years ago, you would switch to a website for secure connections only while logging on. The website would then give you back a so-called session cookie and drop you back to non-secured communications, maintaining that authenticated session, which you achieved by giving your username and password, even when you were no longer secure. What that meant was that anything that was trying to protect the enterprise from evil stuff, malware getting in, could do a sufficiently good job by screening the non-secure web traffic. What's happened, though, especially over the last year, is that with like major pushes from the EFF and even from Google to move us to an always secured mode while we're surfing the net, is that unless the enterprise essentially eavesdrops upon its own internal users, in order to break that encryption and see into their communications in order to do malware and, you know, general AV scanning, unless they do that, they're no longer able to protect the enterprise. Right. So we've seen lots of change.
Absolutely. Steve, one of the things that we've seen over the past year has been, I won't say a sea change, but there's definitely been a recognition within the enterprise, at least those proactive elements of the enterprise, that what we had been prescribing before, encrypt, use VPNs everywhere, doesn't necessarily mean more security anymore. Much of the old paradigm was based on the idea that you had safe zones, and the safe zone was your PC is safe, and the network, the enterprise network, is safe. And so if you could protect your communications between the two with VPN, with strong encryption, you were golden. What we've seen, especially this last year, with what we've seen at Target and Home Depot and with Sony, was that you can no longer assume that those safe zones are safe, and you can no longer assume that there's a place where you can store anything unencrypted and expect it not to be touched.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. One of the concepts that is important, I think, when talking about security and privacy, is to understand that none of this is absolute, that it is porous, and that essentially you're putting up a barrier to prevent casual penetration, but that a sufficiently well-motivated enemy can almost always still get in. And I mean, a simple real-world analogy is locking your front door. Well, you can lock your front door and lock your windows, but we know that prevents a casual person from gaining entry. But if they have lock picking skills, they can pick the lock. Or if they have a brick, they can throw it through the window. So again, it's not absolute unless you really raise the barriers. And then, of course, you start creating a problem for the people, you know, who have, like, you know, seven locks on their front door. And every time they go out and come in, they have to deal with all of those.
See, over the past year, we've heard a few things. Like, for example, the web consortium was talking about moving to a HTTP standard that would do end-to-end encryption and essentially encrypt the entire internet, keep everything under lock and key.
Right.
What, I mean, those proposals sound great, but they never seem to go anywhere.
Well, yeah. And in the case of end-to-end encryption, what they were talking about was not going to provide identity. That's, you know, the idea of encrypting everything is easy if you're not concerned about a man in the middle attack. What a certificate does is it assures you that there has been no interception of the traffic. If you simply do what's called opportunistic encryption, where you say, let's always encrypt everything, the problem is if somebody wanted to get in the middle, then you always encrypt to them and they always encrypt to the endpoint, and you can't detect that. It's only by using a certificate that you're able to hopefully verify that there isn't anybody who stuck themselves in the middle. Right. So that's sort of it's better to have it than not, but you need to then not assume that means that nobody is eavesdropping, because opportunistic encryption doesn't prevent eavesdropping.
It's not a complete analog, but we did just kind of get outraged over the past 3 months over the use of dirt boxes by the DOJ. And that's exactly it. My phone conversation is encrypted to the tower, and that's strong encryption. The problem is, what if someone else owns the tower? And so I can't guarantee that once it's been decrypted that my communications isn't being used for something I would prefer it not to be used. I want to change channels a little bit here. Encryption is a great topic, and we will continue to talk about it in the last segment of the show. But I did want to talk a little bit about your thoughts on data retention. Now, there are a couple of different facets for this. For the outward-facing enterprise, so this is your internet company, this is your Google, your Facebook, Yahoo, whatever it may be, there's now the question of, well, how long do you hold on to customer information? How long do you hold on to search results? How long do you hold on to the data that you've been collecting? Now, on the inside, so an enterprise that's not public-facing, there's also the question of how long do we keep our records in digital format if maybe we don't trust that our network is completely secure?
Yeah, I think that data retention is a crucially important concept. The problem with digital stuff is that it is theoretically easy to keep it forever. We see, for example, mass storage prices falling at such a rate that there is no longer ever a need to throw anything away. Yet Sony, for example, got themselves in extra trouble because they still had records available for exfiltration from their network from decades ago, arguably absolutely unnecessary for any real business purpose, but because they didn't have a formal policy for aging off old data, that it just stayed there and it was vulnerable. I really like the idea from a philosophical standpoint, from a sort of a theoretical privacy and security standpoint, that data past a certain age ought to decay. It ought to just sort of evaporate, so that and if we had sort of that concept and honored it, we would know, for example, that footprints that we had left on the internet, say, 3 years ago. 3 years is sort of feels like the right kind of time, because it's, you know, if you haven't gone back to a website in 3 years, you probably just as well it forgot all about you. And it would be nice to know that places you hadn't visited in that length of time, you no longer needed to worry about. They'd erased your authentication information and your old email address and any knowledge of you, just sort of the way it works more in the real world.
Steve, we've sort of poked the hornet's nest here in the chat room. We've got a couple of guys, Specs, Retro D, basically saying, wait a minute, you know, data never dies. Data always lives on the internet. In fact, right now my video is dead because that data has died. Well, we're going to put a bug here. Something happened to the camera. I think the camera was just tired of me. It was like, you know what? I'm done with this. Oh, did it die?
Yeah, I think just power turned off.
Burke!
There was a power failure. I guess it was yesterday. A little brief glitch during Leo's Twitch podcast.
And we're still suffering from that. We think it's probably messed up some of the settings across the brick house. We may have to. Yeah, let's put. Where should I go back? Yeah, I'll take it back to the toss. All right, and three, two. Steve, we've poked the hornet's nest a little bit. We've got Retro D and Specs in the chat room who are both pointing out that, look, data never dies. At least this is what we've learned on the internet, right? Data always lives on in some way, shape, or form. It's probably been copied. It's probably been put someplace else. But I think the philosophical piece that we're talking about is that if you are a responsible IT manager, and whether or not your enterprise is public-facing or private-facing, you should have some policy to guarantee that as this data is no longer needed, it's not just stored forever, so that you have one repository of information that when your corporation, your network gets breached, will be available to the outside world.
And there is an interesting sort of halfway measure, too. You could have a policy of taking older data physically offline, that is, transferring it into archival hard drives or optical storage, and then literally putting it in a vault, moving it to a place where if there's truly a need for it, you have access to it. Maybe leave the index online, but move the content itself physically offline, so that, you know, sort of like Amazon's Glacier system, where they give you a lower rate because this stuff is not instantly available. But if you give them notice, they can arrange to mount it on some hardware in order to give you access. So it's not so much that it has to forever disappear. And we ought to make a clarification too. We're not talking about things like, medical studies, which are clearly useful to go back 20 years and be able to have indexed and search around. We're talking about personal login information on websites. So the other notion is, in sort of this theoretical sense, that we would develop the notion of classes of information, stuff that should age out, and other stuff that's really truly valuable to have archived for the ages.
Right. Yeah. I think we need to make that clarification for our chat room so that they don't kill us. And that is, there's a difference between information that you make publicly available to the internet. That's always going to live on in some form. I think what Steve and I are talking about is, for example, with Sony, they had employment and HR records that went back 20 years. There was no reason for those to still exist. They didn't work for Sony anymore, and it really hurt them. I'm sorry, Steve.
It hurt them, and it hurt the people who were, who had no relationship with Sony for all that time. Yet this thing came back to bite them. So Sony could have minimized the damage from that if they had a policy of, if nothing else, taking that stuff offline so it wasn't available to attackers elsewhere on the globe.
Yeah. We're going to have a special episode on that data management, because we've had people on before talking about data management systems, but most systems today assume that you want to save everything. It'd be interesting if we could go back to the old way. And the old way, this is the way that I think every panelist on this show today grew up, knowing that there was some data that you could keep offline. And we've lost that.
Well, the problem is it's gotten so cheap. Yeah. It's ridiculously, and it's like shockingly inexpensive today. To the point where cloud providers are just, they keep expanding the amount of free storage they'll make available faster than we can fill it up. Especially if you're Chibert there with the bandwidth connection.
I've got Chibert yelling at me in the private chat saying, "Oh, I want to jump in here." We're gonna bring them right back. We're actually gonna come back. We're gonna sum this up, and we're actually going to put this in the context of recent events that talk about data privacy and encryption. But before that, let's go ahead and thank the third sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it's ZipRecruiter. Now, these days, hiring is more than just finding the qualified person. I mean, that's actually quite easy. There's always going to be someone who can fill the seat. But now it's all about finding that qualified candidate who can fit into the culture of your business. I've done my share of hiring, and the process was always the same. You post a job listing, you get candidates, you screen the candidates, you hire the best candidate, and then you regret it half the time because of that cultural issue. The problem is that you need to cast as wide a net as possible to ensure that you're getting the best candidates, and you need to put your posting in places where you'll find those candidates who are right for your position and your culture. That's why we're proud to have ZipRecruiter as part of the Twiat Riot. ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in one place isn't enough. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites. And that's what ZipRecruiter does for you. With ZipRecruiter.com, you post your job once, and it gets placed on 50-plus job sites, including Craigslist, LinkedIn, and Twitter, all with a single click. ZipRecruiter will help you find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post once and watch your qualified candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. There'll be no juggling of emails or calls to your office. Instead, you'll quickly screen your candidates, rate them, and hire the right person fast. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 250,000 businesses. Right now, our listeners can try ZipRecruiter for free. For a free 4-day trial, go to ziprecruiter.com/twiet. That's ziprecruiter.com/twiet. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. Let's get back into the heat of the action. Chiebert, Brian, and Curtis, you guys have been kind of chomping at the bit a little bit. I've seen you in the private chat. You've been wanting to jump in here on this whole data retention idea. Could you quickly rant out so we can get this off the table? Either one of you first.
Well, first off, I totally agree with Steve. Spinning disk in solid state has gotten so cheap that people just keep it around forever. But back in the late 80s, early 90s, when spinning disks were really expensive, there's a really hot topic about data grooming. In fact, Microsoft's storage server actually has modules that are still there, still being updated, still being improved, where you can actually set business rules so that files will be groomed off to a optical robot, offline, what have you, but the metadata will stay there. So you can actually still search for it and so forth, and when you touch it, it will automatically generate an operator interrupt to be able to pull it back offline. I'm actually using this kind of concept for storing hydrophone data for the Aloha Cabled Observatory. We will actually take older data, we'll actually burn it to a Blu-ray, we'll burn two copies. One will go to a salt mine, one will become the operational, and that way people can still get access to the data, still use the data, but it's not clogging up spinning disks, it costs money, and it's also not vulnerable. So I totally agree with Steve on this. I think that's something a lot of people need to take a good hard look at, because you still need to have your fiduciary responsibility of having the data available, having it organized, so forth. But it makes a lot of sense to have it offline and no longer vulnerable.
Curtis, do you think that in the enterprise there are a lot of executives who understand that although having all that data, all your records available online at any time is very nice, it's very convenient, it's not necessarily the best security to have?
Well, I think that from the point of view of most executives, it's not even really a security issue. This is why in many companies, when you get to data retention policies, pardon me, one of the key people on the committee making decisions is the company's corporate counsel. Because, you know, we've been talking about the physical security, whether people can get at it. An issue that is at least as big as that is what happens to information when someone who sues you comes after it in the process of discovery. That's where you really need to have a policy that says that unless there is an absolute requirement that the data be kept for a longer period of time, at a certain point, data ages out and is discarded or destroyed. That way, if discovery is ever done and people say, well, why isn't the data from 10 years ago available? You can say, well, because of policy, not because we feared this particular lawsuit, but because of policy, we got rid of it. You know, a lot of companies do this on a smaller scale. I know that my father, for example, worked for a large defense contractor. And one of their pieces of policy was that every day you could take notes on 3x5 cards that were labeled with your name, and you know, the company gave them to you. They were very nice looking. And at the end of every day, you took all of those cards that you had made notes on, and you either transcribed the information into the corporate record keeping system in one form or another, or you threw them away. You didn't keep random pieces of paper hanging around. That same policy extended to all of their data. And I think it's something that most major corporations have, and almost all small businesses and smaller enterprises should have in place from a legal protection standpoint.
Well, gentlemen, we've got about 15 minutes left in the episode, and I really want to get Steve's and your eyes on a situation that's bubbling up right now. Let me set the background. Back in December, Spain arrested 11 people at 14 different locations that were raided, and they seized computers, books, leaflets, basically everything that they get their hands on. They released four, but they held on to seven on charges of undefined terrorism. Now, the reasons given for holding those sevens included possessions of certain books, the production and publication of certain forms of communication, and the use, this is the big one, the use of emails with extreme security measures. In other words, they saw that they were using Rise Up, which is a secure encrypted email service, and therefore that was tantamount to suspicion of terrorism. Now, we also heard that UK PM David Cameron wanted to remove encryption. He was speaking after the events of Charlie Hebdo and the related attacks in France, and he said, and I quote, "Are we going to allow a means of communication which is simply not possible to read?" He asked, my answer to that question is no, we must not. Now, that was kind of in the back burner, but then late last week, President Obama threw in on the issue and essentially equated encryption with terrorism. This past Friday, he, speaking to the public, joined the voices of spies, the FBI, and the UK Prime Minister David Cameron in concluding that encryption was hindering law enforcement and anti-terrorism efforts. Specifically, he stated, and I quote, "If we find evidence of a terrorist plot, and despite having a phone number, despite having a social media address or email address, we can't penetrate that, that's a problem." And he goes on to say that he believes Silicon Valley wants to solve the problem and that they should if they're patriots. Okay, Steve, I'm going to give this to you first because this actually kind of disturbs me. I don't want to go all out here. I want to keep this nice and balanced. But this idea that we should weaken our encryption or that Silicon Valley and high-tech companies should somehow cook in a back door, make their encryption a little bit weaker, maybe violate best practices on data retention in order to make the law enforcement's job easier, is that an issue? Is that a problem?
Okay, so this is a difficult subject to discuss because this is a place where details matter. Mm-hmm. And it's hot politically, and sound bites get us in trouble. My head has been like, well, the term is exploding. Obviously, it hasn't exploded yet. But for the last week, I've been reading the well-intended press talking about, the word everyone bandies about is backdoor. And the fact is, it is absolutely possible to give the government the ability to decrypt communications without weakening it in any way, which, I mean, from a pure cryptographical standpoint, we can do that. I want to be extremely clear, though, that I'm not suggesting that we should or advocating it, but I want to separate the one nonsense argument that I've read it in the press over and over. Everyone who is not a cryptographer talks about backdoors weakening security. Absolutely not necessary. The technology exists trivially today to do that. The question is, do we want to employ that? Do we want to? Are we going to have? Are we going to face laws that require it? Are we going to criminalize the use of encryption that doesn't? The problem is we keep. Even I am stumbling over the term backdoor because it's so common.
Right.
But unfortunately, it's a bad term. Just to give you a sense for this, we already have the notion of public key cryptography, where to encrypt a message, a random number is chosen, and that random number serves as the key for performing the bulk encryption. Then we use public key cryptography to encrypt that random key and attach it to the message. we can use the same technology to essentially double key the crypto so that a government master key has the ability to also decrypt the message. So from a cryptographic standpoint, it is no weaker than the crypto that we're using right now everywhere on the internet, except that the very fact that there is a second key is something that you need to protect. And I've been trying to remember this week the old saying, something like, a secret that you tell one other person is no longer a secret, meaning that, you know, if you give anybody else any access to something which you otherwise really have to keep secret, it's no longer a secret. And that's why, you know, I coined the acronym TNO, Trust No One, on the Security Now podcast years ago, because I wanted to embody the notion that an individual who wanted to keep something secret was only able to really do that if they trusted no one else. So for what it's worth, we need to separate from a policy standpoint and from a technology standpoint this notion that we have to weaken crypto in order to create, again, that it's funny how overused the term backdoor is. Backdoor has acquired a very bad rap. Mm-hmm. The old school notion of a backdoor was that there would be a known defect in the crypto that allowed universal access by an agency that knew the defect. The problem then was that if the defect became more widely known, bad guys could use it too. I mean, that it's great for sci-fi and for mystery stories and things. The fact is, though, that we can, in using today's technology, multiply key the data that we're encrypting such that a government master key could exist that would not otherwise weaken the crypto in any way. The question is, do we want to do it optionally, voluntarily? Would it be a situation where, for example, if you using the communications, for example, of the people in Spain, where the government said to them, you must decrypt this to prove to us that it isn't illegal content. Otherwise, under the laws that we've adopted, we're going to assume it is illegal. I mean, you know, there's all kinds of ways this can be rolled, but, you know, the math is here. We can use the math to create whatever kind of scenario we want. The question is, what do we want?
I think that's an absolutely important distinction to draw, because whenever we hear backdoor, I think you're right, Steve, we're used to saying, oh, well, you're just going to weaken the encryption. You're going to make it so that so-and-so can get in, and it's going to have all these unintended consequences. You're absolutely right. We could do this the right way, but we would all have to agree to do it the right way. Cheever, let me throw this to you, because I don't want this to become, oh, look at these stupid politicians, bash, bash, bash. There actually is, and I'm probably going to get some hate for this, there is a legitimate reason to say that LE should be able to read communications that they need to be able to read. Where do you fall? I mean, obviously you've got some vested interest here, but where do you fall?
Well, I actually fall in the category of, like, you handle switches now. You know, if someone's going to do a telephone tap, there needs to be a process. We can't just willy-nilly have access to everything. So I would like to see something along the lines of handling it like wiretaps. Now, as far as people going and saying, you know, dual encryption feeds is not that hard or going to weaken things, let me remind you, I actually had, as a professor, W. Wesley Peterson, who in 1961 wrote a paper on a mathematical representation of data for error correction, who became the father of the modern CRC and is what modern data encryption is based on. And in my crypto class from Dr. Peterson, it was actually proposed that, you know, splitting it off, you know, it's almost a man in the middle type of thing. But you could have it at the VPN level. You could have it at a VPN gateway. You could have it at SSL VPNs. There are ways to do this that isn't hard. This is not a technology question. This is a policy question.
Right.
And if we go back far enough, the Clipper chip actually had this built in, and the Clipper chip wasn't a weak encryption. It was a strong encryption. And I actually supported that because when you have ubiquitous strong encryption, lots of interesting things happen. But the Clipper chip was designed to make those venues open, make those channels open for law enforcement. So that's kind of where I stand.
Curtis, do you agree with that? Is it not a technology question? Are we really talking about a policy question? Do we have the technology to do it right? We just don't have the political will to propose it in the right way.
Oh, I absolutely agree that it is not a technology issue. I will stipulate that Steve is absolutely correct on this issue, that we have the ability to do this without significantly compromising the data integrity involved in any of the transactions. I will stipulate that. To me, it comes down to the following question. As a citizen, do I have the responsibility to allow the government to read any of my communications they want to, anytime they want to? And to me, the answer is no. It's very simple. It's like if I did a manual code, if I simply came up with a cryptographic system and hand wrote a message, do I have a legal obligation to send a copy of the key to the FBI? Because it is, to me, exactly the same thing. And I would say no, that I don't. And frankly, the notion that we have a system in place legally to protect the interest of citizens has been proven to be false, because we know that the FISA court have, in fact, denied warrants. And in those cases, the FBI has simply written itself a national security letter, okaying it. So it's just a question for certain law enforcement about which legal nicety they decide to honor. Do I worry a little bit about what might be passed? Yes. But frankly, in my mind, allowing some of that to pass is the cost of free communications among free citizens. And in my case, I'm willing to pay that cost.
Steve, I want to give you the last question of the episode.
One thing I want to say is that I've been paying a lot of attention post the attacks in Paris. And one of the good things that's happened is that in looking at the response to these recent attacks, people have looked at the U.S.'s post 9/11 response with the Patriot Act, for example, among other things, and have drawn the conclusion that the U.S. probably overreacted. And so you know, as a global society, we're a little young at dealing with the consequences of this sort of, you know, virulent asymmetric warfare and terrorism. And, you know, so we're struggling to figure out what we need to do about it. And of course, the real problem too is that our lawmakers are I would argue unqualified to make these sorts of judgments. They pull in experts who tell them, and then they ignore the experts. They basically get credit for asking the experts, but then don't take their advice, and we end up with a mess. So I'm hopeful that because we're beginning to get some experience with this, and we're able now to look back over a decade of response and say, let's be careful, because last time maybe we went too far, and we've seen some consequences of that.
Gentlemen, I want to keep talking. I want to keep going, but unfortunately, we've actually gone way over our time. Ladies and gentlemen, that's right. You've used up another hour listening to the best dang podcast, enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 NSA analysts who are currently listening to the show. I want to thank my panelists for being here, especially to you, Steve. Steve Gibson from Security Now, 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time every Tuesday. If you want to know more about security, if you want to go in depth on encryption, that's where you want to go. Could you please tell the Twiet Riot where you are, where they can find your work, where they can find, of course, SpinRight?
I'm at grc.com, Gibson Research Corporation, grc.com. I monitor my Twitter feed. That's SGGRC. You can remember that as Steve Gibson at Gibson Research Corporation, SGGRC. And everything I do basically is financed by SpinRight, the hard drive data recovery and maintenance utility that I wrote truly decades ago, back before we had mice and graphical user interfaces on character mode DOS. And the thing has been evolving over the decades and is still recovering data for people all the time. That's again at grc.com.
You know, just a little personal plug I want to give you. Your tool, SpinRight, has saved more data for me than I probably currently store in the cloud. It is something that I think every geek needs to have in his toolbox. And one more time, where do they go to find out more about SpinRight and to pick up a copy?
grc.com/SpinRight. And it's back then, back in the DOS days, applications could only have 8 characters in their name.
That's right.
So it's SpinRite. I had to spell it a little funky in order to get it down into 8 characters. And in fact, the very first version of SpinRite was a .com file.
That's right.
It was less than 64K.
Oh my gosh, you're bringing me back. I completely forgot about the character limit. I have an entire drive that's filled with documents that I know the character combinations made sense to me back then, but now I'm just looking and I'm going, it's like a license plate.
Right.
Steve Gibson, thank you very much for being on Twiet. It is always a pleasure to have you on. We're going to have you on again for another encryption special because this was just too short.
Thanks, everybody.
Yeah. Now, I also want to thank my co-hosts because we wouldn't be able to do this show without them, starting with Mr. Brian Chi. Again, today he's Super Mario. He's 8-bit. He's coming to us from a low bandwidth connection. Chibert, what are you up to? What should the Twiet Riot know about you and where can they find you?
Well, right now, I am negotiating with a whole bunch of future guests, including a company that makes Blu-ray robots, Blu-ray jukeboxes, that implements the archiving rules that I talked about during the show.
Nice.
And then naturally, your video and audio has become absolutely perfect at the end of the show. Go figure. Also, my other co-host is Curtis Franklin, who is an executive over Information Week Radio. If you want to know what's going on with UBM, with UBM events, he is the man to go to. Curtis, where do they have you going off to this week?
Well, later this week, I will be at FETC, which is a very, very large educational technology conference in Orlando. I'll be talking to a bunch of people, putting various sorts of technology in the schools. Tomorrow, I have Tania Hurst, who's a woman who's doing great things in the maker movement as part of Interop Radio. That's at 3 o'clock p.m. Eastern time over on Blog Talk Radio. It's also now on iTunes, so feel free to look us up there. End of the week, I've got Information Week Live, our radio program, on Friday at 3 p.m., and then next week, I'm on the road again. Actually going to be out in San Francisco all week.
You got to stop by. You can stay at my place. We have cookies and bacon. Actually, we do have a light of bacon. It's weird. Gentlemen, thank you very much again. A great episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Of course, I want to thank you. That's right, the person who watches this show every week. We wouldn't have a show without you. And so we want to make it easier for you to get This Week in Enterprise Tech into your device of choice. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/Twiet. There you'll find our back catalog in case you want to download a previous episode to catch up on some of the things we've been talking about in the enterprise. You'll also get a drop-down menu that will let you select an automatic download. for your iPod, for your iPad, for your iPhone, for your Android tablet or phone, for your Mac, for your PC, Windows, desktop, laptop, whatever it may be, we've got a format for you so you can listen in the car, at the office, at home, or snuggle up in front of your big screen TV. Also, don't forget that you can follow me on Twitter at twitter.com/PadreSJ. That's at PadreSJ. If you follow me, you'll find out not just what I'm doing every week on every show that I do on the TwitTV network. That includes This Week in Enterprise Tech on Monday, Padre's Corner on Tuesday, and Know How Encoding 101 on Thursday. But you'll find out what I do in the morning, like this dog who was reacting to the Packers-Seahawks game. Yeah, that was kind of devastating. Also, don't forget that we have a lot of people here in the Brick House who make this show possible. From Lisa to Leo, who let me do this show every week, to Carson, my super producer, and of course, my TD, the man who is really the wind beneath my wings, the cranky hippo, Mr. Brian Burnett. Brian, where can they find you on the Twit TV network?
They can find me with you on Thursdays at 11 a.m. Pacific. And yeah, we do Know How together. Last week we had a lot of fun playing with, what was it called?
Gallium.
Yeah. So yeah, if, tune into that, learn something every day. And I'm excited. Previously, when Leo ran through and said that we're going to do a drone school now.
Yes,
we are.
We're
going to teach everyone how to fly drones around.
That's right. We're building an Air Force. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballasaire, just reminding you that if you want to know what's going on in the Enterprise, just keep quiet.